Okay, so again, are you able to see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so coming to lecture one, today I will discuss about introduction to course, and this course is all about linear algebra, and content of today's lectures are the following. So I am coming to outline. First, I would like to discuss about course information. I have already shared this slide. Annotated slide, I will share it after this class, and a fresh slide I have already shared it. So content of today's class are the following. First, I would like to discuss about course information, where I will discuss about course logistic and assessment in detail. Then I will go to course overview, that means why we are reading this course and what kind of things you will go through in this course, during this course. And don't worry about that. You have already gone through two mathematical courses. Those are calculus and differential equations. Those looks also computational perspective, very good. But this one, linear algebra, is also one of the interesting kind of mathematical course which give a direct optimal computational perspective. So those things you will see it here. Then I will go to discuss about few motivation behind reading linear algebra. Then at last, I will discuss few examples as well. So now I'm coming to first part of today's course, that course information. So what is course information? So first thing I would like to discuss about objective and outcome. So what is the objective of linear algebra? Here we'll see that there are many remarkable progress in engineering science, or basically electronics and communication, using computational technique. That one is coming from linear algebra. Objective of this course are twofolded. One is to develop a solid understanding of linear algebra with each computational technique. Those technique, computational technique, which is helping in engineering science, and to study this technique and new results with few more applications. And outcome, what it would be, you can use this technique in your incoming academic and industrial life. Now I'm coming to course link. I had already shared in the mail. So first thing that I discuss about Google link, it is already given here. Google link classroom, Google classroom link, it is especially for assignment, tutorial, and exams, quizzes and exams would be there. And someone who till now haven't joined, inform your classmate to join it with the code is already given here. With the help of this code, you can join. You can join the Google this class in Google Classroom. So inform all your classmates. Don't inform outside your classmate. It is only meant for EC student who have taken linear algebra. Then I have given Google Meet link. So Google Meet is especially for online interaction and online classes, and Google Classroom for other things in this course. So these two will go together in class in this course. And what about email ID? Better use institute email. Why? Because institute email, it is a paid version. Institute is paying that, and due to that you can get a maximum use of G Suite. So you will get a lot of benefit using institute mail. Okay, now I'm coming to syllabus of this course. So what are, there are five modules. In first module, we will discuss about system of linear equations, especially, and you all might have already aware that concept from your high school algebra as well. So you will see here matrix formalism and geometric properties of system of linear equation as a row picture and column picture. In module 2, we'll talk about central concept of linear algebra. Those would be very much beneficial in other courses as well. Here we will talk about few specific linear transformation. Those are rotation, reflection, and orthogonal projections. Apart from that, we will talk about vector space, subspace, image and kernel, linear independence, basis, coordinates, and dimension. And in module 3, we will talk about orthogonality and determinant in general perspective, because you have already seen in coordinate geometry that if you go in coordinate geometry, you observe in plane there are two perpendicular axes. One is x-axis, another one is y-axis, and both happens to be perpendicular. So another name of perpendicular is orthogonal. So if you take any point in the plane, then easily you can represent as a coordinate system. That first coordinate, suppose you are taking 1.12, so first coordinate is 1 and second coordinate is 2. Simply you are saying that one unit you are moving along x-axis, and two unit, that means one unit you are moving along x-axis, and then two unit you are moving along y-axis. So this kind of thing is what you observe here. Orthogonality picture is coming, so that's way it looks easy to deal in plane with the help of orthogonal coordinate system. So if you are going for higher dimension, so in order to see a better picture, you have to go through orthogonality picture. So that's where purpose of this module is only that kind of thing. So in module 4, we will discuss about eigenpairs of a operator or a matrix. So generally two kind of eigenpair things are coming here. One is eigenvalue, another one is eigenvector. So we will discuss in detail. And with the help of eigenpairs, we can decompose a matrix or a operator into very simple form. So in order to solve a problem in a very simple approach. So those kind of things we will discuss here. And at the last module is, okay, so only 4 module. I'll remove the last module. It would be, if time permit, then we will go for application. So now I'm coming to course assessment. So course assessment, it is all about 4 exams would be there in this course. Here, out of 4, 2 quizzes would be there and 2 terms exams would be there. One would be midterm, another would be end term. And I have already given marks distribution, 20% marks. It will come from assignment, class participation, or sometime I may assign minor project as well. It will depends upon module wise. And then 30% it will come from quizzes. So 15% for first quiz, and it is a syllabus and everything is already mentioned there, and 15% for quiz 2. There would be 2 quiz, 1 quiz before midterm, another quiz after midterm and before enter. Then 25% it would come from midterm, and syllabus is already mentioned there. So whatever I am discussing here, everything I will follow throughout the class. 25% it will come from enter. So syllabus is again already mentioned here. So now I'm coming to assessment further, timetable and my detail, instructor details. So assignment, time to time I will assign assignment, homework, and maximum it would be 5 or 6, something like that. So you have to submit your assignment 1 week after it is already assigned. Timetable, so it is already given in course timetable, but again you can see Monday 9 to 9:45, Tuesday 10 to 10:45, Wednesday 11 to 11:45, and Thursday it would be completely tutorial class. So in tutorial, what we will do, we will do some hands-on on linear algebra in R programming. So R program, why you may ask one question, why I'm using R programming? Because R is free and it is very suitable for data science, linear algebra, machine learning, and many kind of things. So that's why I'm going for that. And MATLAB, it is a paid version, but I'm not using R. I find very interesting. That's why I'm going for that. If someone is willing to go for Python, it's fine. There is no issue. But R, there is no much difference between R and Python. So R is having a dedicated website where name is CRAN, CRAN. You can go and find a lot of information regarding R. So that's why I'm going for R, CRAN. You can get a lot of information here. It is dedicatedly mentioned for R. Now, coming to instructor detail, my name is Dr. Lakshman Mahato. I'm an assistant professor from IIT Dharwad. And you can communicate to any of these two mail. This one, lakshman@IIITdw.ac.in. It is official mail. And also you can look into this Gmail as well. And my home page, if you want to look further about me, my research field and previous teaching, you can look into my home page. Address is already given here. Now coming to references. So what are the references? So actually, whatever lecture notes I will provide in this course, that will be self-sufficient. And most of question and answer will come from that lecture notes itself. And I mentioned that I will provide first slide prior to class and another slide after the class. So I will keep on providing regularly. So if you want to look into textbooks apart from lecture notes, then I would like to suggest Introduction to Linear Algebra by Gilbert Erskine. You might be already aware of Gilbert Erskine. He is from MIT and he is 75 plus year old and very enthusiastic teacher. He's very, what, just go and find in YouTube, you will get several lectures of Gilbert Erskine on linear algebra. You can look into those lectures as well in YouTube and MIT open courseware, MIT OCW open courseware. You can look into that as well. So he is a very interesting kind of person. Till now he is very active. Other references books are here. Kenneth Hoffman. This book is linear. This book is a very compact kind of book. If you want to see your career in linear algebra, you can look into this book. Another, there is one more book from Gilbert Erskine, that name is Linear Algebra and Application. You can also look into this book as well. But as a textbook, I would like to prefer this Introduction to Linear Algebra. Now, here I'm talking about prerequisite. So there is no prerequisite here. It will be self-contained as much as possible, but you may have working knowledge of the following courses that you have already gone through in high school: linear equations, quadratic equation, matrices, and those kind of things. You can recall those things, and those are, I think, you won't find difficulty in recalling those things. Apart from that, in calculus, you have already gone through gradient and Hessian and Taylor expansion. You can recall those things. Time by time, it will come on. Like Hessian, it happens to be a matrix. Gradient, it is a vector, and Taylor approximation, it is talking about approximation of a function, that kind of thing. So, and Taylor approximation expansion is always involve gradient, Hessian, other kind of things. So that's why I had mentioned this. So just you have to recall these things from your previous courses, and time by time, if needed, I will explain those things as well. Apart from that, if it's a real class, you need to do a hands-on on linear algebra. So for that perspective, recall algorithm that you might have already gone through and programming language. So basically here I told that I will preferably use R. So there is no issue with R. It is very simple language. Now I'm coming to course overview. So what is linear algebra? So linear algebra, it is the art and science of making the most of linearized approximation of a given system. You might have already observed around yourself, most of things happen nonlinear in nature. So what do you do? For example, take robot. Robot, it is mimicking human behavior. Okay, it is working like human. But if you try to see in a close picture, then robot is not a nonlinear kind of things. Actually, it is a piecewise linear. So robot, you can approximate robot with the help of piecewise linear system. So robot, you can say it is a piecewise linear system. Piecewise I would like to say piecewise linear system. So whenever there is a linear system, in order to explain completely a linear system, you need to know linear algebra. So that's why we are studying linear algebra. So wherever it will come, a linear system will come, we have to know linear algebra in a details in order to explain a linear system. So robot is a piecewise linear system. Definitely we need to know linear algebra. Without this, you can't explain robot in a proper way. So you have probably all might have encountered the following concept in the previous semesters, like function. You have already studied in calculus, but if you see apart from calculus in your other electronics and communication courses, you might have already encountered this word signal. So signal is what? Actually, it is a function. So we have to now onward we have to see signal as a function. So for example, I am taking a function of one variable. Signal as a function of one variable. That one is high temperature. If we observe high temperature, it always happens to be function of time. Time wise, we record temperature. So that's why temperature is a function of time. And another name, if you go in a probability random process in next courses, so that regarding we can call it time series data. So what we do? So in a particular, in different day, we have noted down these temperature 96, 92, all these temperatures we have noted down. All these are in Fahrenheit. So we have noted down all these temperatures. So these are time series data. And we can observe that it is a function of your temperature, it is a function of time. So you need to plot that. So if you want to plot, then you will observe this kind of pattern. There are many ways to plot data or a function. So one plot is this one. So it is temperature versus day. Okay. So here temperature was a signal. So we can see several kind of signal, continuous signal, discrete signal kind of things. So further, so one example, one more example we are taking, continuous signal. We are taking a cosine signal with respect to function. So what is cosine signal? What we observe? So where you observe cosine signal? So it generally cosine or sine or sinusoidal signal, it is coming when there is a periodic phenomena. So what kind of periodic phenomena? So in everyday life, you observe several periodic phenomena, like itself, your activity. Every day, you repeat your activity. Every day, you repeat. So it is periodic in nature. So if you see your semesters or academic, every semester, you have to take many courses, or you have to go through, again, teaching and learning, studying and learning process. So again, that thing is a periodic phenomena. So everywhere you are observing periodic phenomena. So that's where. So what is meaning of periodic phenomena? So it happens that just a periodic, it is composition of pulse with a fixed period. Take a pulse and if pulse keep on repeating, then you are getting a periodic wave. So that kind of thing. So here cosine, it is a pulse with period 2 pi and keep on rotating. So in that keep on repeating, in that process you are getting cosine function. It is defined over throughout R for every time. So here if you want to represent a periodic signal, so you need a few things. You need a frequency. So this frequency F naught, it is calling it initial frequency. This one is sample frequency. These things I will explain later. So it is a continuous signal. So one example I have already given here. So I told that when you are talking about continuous signal as a function, then the signal xt, it would be a function of time. It will vary continuously. Then you can go for discrete signal. In the discrete signal, the argument, it will take discrete value. Like this state is a discrete state. Okay. Now, so when you are discussing about continuous signal and discrete signal, very important kind of thing is coming amplitude. So amplitude, again, it can be two types of amplitude. One is analog and amplitude. That means amplitude varying continuously. Here It is varying continuously. Another one is discrete amplitude. It is taking discrete value, minus 1 and 1. So that kind of things here and here. Okay. So now I'm coming to signal and system. So systems, it operate upon signal to produce a new signal. If you have one signal and like input signal, like if you have a pendulum, then how much input, how much control, how much force you will apply on the pendulum so that it will move up to certain height. That height would be your output, and the force, it would be input, control input kind of things. So those things would come here. So there is a system, that pendulum system, it operates up to one force signal, it is giving some height kind of signal. Those things are coming here. So one example here I have taken. So suppose XT is your input signal, you are applying some system property T over XT, and you are getting output YT. So that's why Y equal to this one you are writing it. This is talking about system with continuous signal, and this is the system with discrete signal. So we are having a continuous time signal. So one example we have taken here. This is the example of continuous signal, or differential, simply take differential equation. That one is example of continuous time signal. And many continuous time signal you observe during audio, image and communication and kind of things. And discrete time signal, when time is taking discrete value, that like 1, 2, 3 kind of thing, then you are observing discrete signal. So like current input, delayed input, or simple in filtering process, you can observe those kind of discrete signal. Okay, now how is this course different from your everyday other courses? Not here optimization. So you can talk about linear algebra is alternative process of optimization, always alternative process of calculus. Even linear algebra is not using calculus. Without using calculus, with the help of linear algebra, you can do optimization as well. So that's where this term I have already taken here. So we typically model a physical or social scenario as a linearized approximation with a precise mathematical and computational description. So here, mathematical and computational description. So we can model any system. I told that with the help of linear algebra, we can model any system in a linearized approximation. So in this linearized model, we apply concept and technique that is coming from linear algebra to get the best solution analytically. So when there is a linear system, it is guaranteed that we can get analytic solution. Whenever we can't find the best solution analytically, we would like to know how far off our proposed solution is. That means we are looking for approximate solution. So linear algebra also, it provides a computing tool. I mentioned that here we will see linear algebra from a computational viewpoint to linearize approximation of a system from science and engineering. That system is coming from science and engineering. For a host of major problems in science and engineering, the best algorithms currently come from the theory of optimization. And I mentioned that linear algebra is also providing alternative tool of optimization. So that's where linear algebra is one of the approach. I'm not saying that it is only approach. Calculus is another approach. One approach is linear algebra. That's it. Linear algebra is a computational course. Foundation works by scientists has led to a shift of focus in optimization theory and linear algebra from mathematical analysis to computational mathematics. Several basic concepts in scientific computing are either special cases or fundamental ingredient of the optimization algorithm. Whenever you observe any kind of algorithm, you need to find a efficient algorithm, an efficient algorithm. So that efficiency is what it is talking about, optimization. So with the help of linear algebra, you are getting optimization algorithm.
Hello sir.
Yes
sir. What is meant by optimization?
Optimization, that means optimization having two meaning. One is minimization, another one is maximization. So suppose you have a function like this quadratic function, and So if I'm asking to what you will do, what is the meaning of optimization of this function? Optimization means where this function is having optimum value, that minimum value. It is having minimum value at zero. Otherwise, if you are in company, I will ask to maximize your profit. So you will have a profit from company, then you will run that company. So in order to get profit, what you do? What your intention would be? Maximize profit. That means you are optimizing profit. So, suppose in the same company, what you do to minimize other than profit? You don't want to minimize profit. So what another things that you will minimize? Can you reply what thing you would like to minimize in your company? It would be cost.
Sir, we can like to minimize the cost of product.
Yeah, cost. You want to minimize cost and you want to maximize profit. So those kind of very optimization is very common in living life. Like if you want at your family, you have already observed that your parent always try to minimize cost in this situation and any situation, and try to maximize saving and other kind of things for your education and your sibling educations, those kind of things. So everywhere you observe optimization. So I think mother is the best person from whom you can learn optimization as well. You can visualize optimization as well. Okay, so I'm coming to least square. Linear algebra technique. One of that is least square. Another one is root finding. Same thing you will study in statistics as well. But that approach would be completely data and data analytic and statistic point of view. But here I can discuss least square with the help of linear algebra. Then we can discuss root finding. We can discuss linear system, solving linear system. We can talk about approximation and fitting. We can talk about matrix factorization. We can talk about conjugate gradients and other kind of things. Now this day, everyone might be aware of Amazon and Flipkart. So what you observe that? There you observe that if you have searched some cell phone or something like that, anything you might have searched, so everywhere in Facebook and YouTube and everywhere, and even in itself in Amazon and Flipkart, you will get recommendation of few things what you had already gone through. So you are getting recommendation kind of things everywhere, even YouTube recommendation. You can call it recommendation advertisement kind of things. So what are these? This one is just a basic linear algebra problem that we are calling it recommendation. It is part collaborative filtering or matrix factorization. So I will discuss in detail that. As an example, I will discuss in application part. So linear algebra, it is playing a very important role. You can Google it out. What is collaborative filtering? What is a recommendation system? Those kind of things you have already encountered in daily life. So you can search, and definitely you will get a lot of exposure of linear algebra there. So I'm talking about here linear algebra as a optimization algorithm as a linear classifier. I told that wherever you will observe linear term, linear algebra is coming. Wherever you observe linear term, so linear algebra is coming. So what things you can see here? One, I'm taking very simple kind of classification problem at learn to classify. Like I received two mails. One mail, it is saying, hello class, homework I have been posted. Homework one has been posted on Gradescope, and it is due on Thursday. My name is appearing here. So after seeing this mail or this message, what you will say whether this message is a genuine message or it is a spam. So definitely my name is coming here. I'm talking about homework, so it would be a genuine message, not a spam. Now you are getting another message that say good day, congratulations, you have won $1,000,000. Click here to claim your prize. Some link would be given here. Okay, so after seeing second message, this message, what kind of things will come in your mind? Definitely this second message is not a genuine message, it is a spam. So how can we classify automatically these two just after getting this data? We don't have to use our brain, we have to use computer's brain. So with the help of computer, with the help of machine learning technique, we have to classify these two things. So how can we can classify? We can classify using some linear classifier. So again, linear, I told that it is coming from linear algebra. So here, what we observe here? Here we observe input as a labeled exam that we are calling it training data set. Then we are having output. That output, it's a classifier. There are two classes. One is a spam, another one is non-spam or genuine message. So basic approach would be, we have to get input output pair here for each mail, and here xi we are calling it feature vector, and yi we are calling it label. So that means -1 for you can call it genuine mail, +1 for a spam, because you want to filter out a spam. So that's where +1 for a spam. So in that process, you can apply support vector machine, one of the very interesting kind of technique. It also provide a linear classification. So here what we do, we have to find a best separating hyperplane between two set of vectors. One set of vector, it is coming in non-spam, another set of vector, it is coming in spam. So there would be several data. So with respect to that, we try to find a classification. So in that process, the optimization problem here, what is it? We have to minimize an objective function that is most clearly expressed using linear algebra. So the minimization algorithm are often solved in the dual space. Dual things I will discuss in detail. Don't worry about dual space. So here, first I will introduce linear system. So our before linear system, you can go for linear equation. So y equal to, you are writing it. I will explain these things in detail. Right now, just write it, observe here. Y equal to A transpose X. A transpose X. So here, X vector, it is your input vector. Y is the observed data. And what is A? A is parameter, someone is saying. Sometimes you have to call it parameter. Another time you can call it dual vector. So those things are, so dual of input vector. So those things I will discuss in later part. So right now, interactive part. I told that you collected several mails. So these are spam point, mint 4, and these are non-spam. So how can you classify? How can you find a classifier? So best classifier, if you look into, it would look like as a best classifier. There would be several hyperplane we can separate these two class of mails. But among, because in there would be infinitely many hyperplane. Hyperplane is, in 2D hyperplane is nothing, just it is a line. So it is, I'm talking about here 2D data. So that's where, so there are many hyperplanes. So which one is the best hyperplane? I will discuss in optimization segment that what you do, best way to find a separating, best separating hyperplane is that make a convex hull of the point. So convex hull, it is just a special kind of a convex set in the set theory. In optimization, it is playing very important role. Convex community, it is talking about. So this is the convex hull. Convex hull of right part and convex hull of this is this, like this. These are algorithmic technique, it is very important. So you got two convex hull. Okay, so now in order to find best, what you do, put a projection of this point over here nearest. So projection things will come again, I will talk. So this is the best, or no, not this will be projection. I will discuss projection, just recall from your vector calc, vector from plus two as well. Right now, this one will be projection and put projection. Okay, so you can observe that this is the shortest distance between these two convex hull. So take a perpendicular bisector of this one, and you will get an optimal linear separator. So in that process, you will get. So that means you will get an optimal hyperplane or optimal line which bisect these two class of male in a very perfect way, optimal way, or optimal. I told optimal, that means maximal or minimal. Okay. So this is the classifier. This classifier and this thing coming in negative part, and this thing is coming in positive part. So it is saying that if this one is the hyperplane, so we are calling it upper half plane H plus, and this one is lower half plane. So those things we are part of linear algebra. We'll discuss in detail. So simply I discuss about how to classify a male, whether it is a spam or whether it is non-spam. Those kind of things easily we can explain with the help of linear algebra. So now I'm coming to motivation. So what are the motivations? So here what we do, linear algebra, before understanding linear algebra, we have to understand what is the computational kind of thing, a special computational property. Like we are coming here. So if suppose we have this kind of number, if you want to compute the product of this, so very lengthy product. So what you do? So in place of doing this computation, what you do? Round it. Rounding, you might be aware of in scientific computation. So round it. So round off part of this one would be 1.2. Round off part of this would be 0.6, and multiply these two and further round up. Round up. So there is a rule for rounding. So you have to. So what you do? So definitely there is some approximation. It is not exact calculation, but very near to perfection. So again, it simplifies your calculation. So similarly, if you do matrix multiplication, how you do matrix multiplication? You take first row of first matrix, then you are multiplying with row of column of second matrix, then you are getting a single element. So it is what kind of things? It is simple dot product of two vector. Dot product of row is coming from first matrix and column is coming from second matrix. So these are computational technique, very simple kind of, or handful computational technique. Now we are coming to some foreground identification. Like if you are having image, how can you identify people there in that image? So in order to get that identification, you have to decompose the images into two parts. One is background, another one is foreground. So how to identify the foreground in a surveillance video? By decomposing a matrix. So you remember that you might have heard somewhere in the courses that if you take a black and white image, it is just a matrix. If you take a black and white image, it is just a matrix. Depends, suppose it is to pixel is a 25 matrix of particle size, 25 by 25. That means what is the pixel size? It is 625. It is an image of 625 pixel. Pixel is the measuring unit of image. You might be already aware of that pixel. Okay, so if you are taking an image, here I have already taken image. So this is the image, measured image. So we are calling it measurement. So how can we get identify people here in this image? This image looks very hazy, a blur. How can you get that? So we have to decompose this image into two parts. One part, this part we are calling it background, and this part we are calling it foreground. So we have decomposed our observed image into two parts. One is background. This first part is background, and second part is foreground. So our intention is how to recover this foreground image. That is the problem. So this problem we can solve with the help of linear algebra. Another problem, we are calling it reconstruction of an image from CT scan. You might be everyone might be aware of CT scan images. So from this, suppose we are having CT scan images. These are the CT scan images or measured image, and these are the readings. So we can reconstruct an image what kind of problem. So it would be very helpful for doctors and other things. So reconstruction, image reconstruction, how can we do that? So it is just a basic linear algebra problem that we will discuss in detail. Another one is topic identification. Suppose I have given a corpus of document, corpus of words in a document. So from the documents, how can you identify a topic? So you might be aware of Google page rank problem. So that one is also similar to this kind of things. So this problem is just also one linear algebra problem. So we can solve it with the help of linear algebra. So we are having a corpus of documents. Definitely we know that document contains a variety of words. From the documents, how can we approximate, how can we identify a topic? So those kind of things we will discuss in detail. Now we are coming to two important visualization of system of linear equation. One is column picture, another one is row picture. So in column picture, what we observe that system of equation, you might have in matrix form, you might have already seen that it is of the form y equal to a time x. Y and x are vector. Y, suppose y belongs to, it is m dimensional vector. Y is your m dimensional vector. And x as an input, it is your n dimensional vector. And A is what? A is matrix. So what kind of matrix? It is matrix of order m by n. It is this matrix form or compact form of system of equation. Okay, what you do, so there are many things. I will discuss all these things in detail in next class, and I will you go to Google Classroom and mark your presence there. And further, if you are willing to ask any question, you are welcome. And if you have any network issue, other kind of things, you can just put your question there in comment box. That I will answer later. So it is already time, I think. We should not go beyond time. Any question? Regarding your attendance, go and mark your attendance in Google Classroom. I have already created one link for attendance. Anyone willing to ask any question, then you are welcome.
Thank you.